It's a pretty amazing thing to know that the Lord God Almighty, the creator of the heavens and of the earth, the one who holds it all together by his mighty power, is a shield for me. Isn't that amazing? That God is your shield. Now, we're in a little series. It's called Overcoming Failure. How many of you have ever had failure in your life? Okay, so welcome to the club. We all deal with failure. Failure's going to come and how we're going to overcome it. Last Sunday, we talked about what? Come on, this is a test. Don't make me go back and preach last Sunday again because I don't have those notes with me. When religion fails, worship in spirit and in truth. And so our worship can't be tied up in the things that hold us down, you know, the stronghold, so to speak. And today what I want to talk to you about is about a man by the name of Gideon. Now, Gideon, we know him for his fleece, right? Gideon threw out the fleece, but Gideon was also a warrior, but he didn't see himself as a warrior. As a matter of fact, Gideon didn't see himself as great whatsoever. So this morning, what I want to take off on is the fact of Gideon and entitled Gideon in Greatness. Because not everybody sees himself as being great, yet God has called us to be great. He's called us to be more than conquerors in the world in which we live. I mean, you think about that dude in the Bible before Gideon, and you got his name is Abraham, you know. And Abraham is called a friend of God. Abraham is called the father of many nations, you know. And he knew what it was like to experience both the highs and the lows in this walk of faith, in this following God, in this honoring God, in this failure before God. He understood that. And he understood the very kinds of things that you and I go through. You know, God established a divine covenant, you know, with Abraham, even though Abraham had huge mistakes and huge mess-ups. And it's amazing to me how God takes people with huge mistakes and with huge mess-ups, and he uses them for his glory. Now, the story of Gideon plays out kind of like an action movie. You know, you think of Gideon, and he plays the role of an unlikely hero, because who is going to choose him to be the hero who rises to the challenge against all the odds to accomplish what is thought to be absolutely impossible? And in his life, you know, are several guidelines that you and I can learn from along the way. We can gather strength from, insight from, wisdom from. And that we can walk with. Now, we all do stupid stuff, right? Who did something stupid this week? I'm glad I'm not alone. You know what I did? I laid my wallet, my iPhone, and my keys on my daughter's bumper Thursday evening. I'm not thinking, you know, I'm just going around the side of the house to check the pool pump. And I got involved, and she drove off. And then I go inside and get a bite of dinner. And I see a guy riding up the driveway on his bicycle. So I go to find out who this is. And he's got my wallet that he found a couple of streets over. And I thought, oh boy. But then I spot my keys laying in the driveway, but no iPhone. So I go back in and get what I need and go out, and I drive the road cautiously and slowly. Round Walton Way, down Foreshore Drive, up Holiday Road, out on the 98. I gave it up at McDonald's and turned around and went home. Then it dawned on me, hey, you can use Find My iPhone. So I figured that out. I looked it up on the web, how to do that. And there it was, just past McDonald's. So I went back and parked in the parking lot of Lovelace Interiors. Got out and thought, I hope nobody from our church sees me walking in the road. And sure enough, there it is, right where Find My iPhone said it was going to be laying. It just didn't tell me it had been run over multiple times. That was pretty stupid. Don't we all do stupid stuff? But if we can learn to follow some of these guidelines that Gideon's life demonstrates and illustrates, we can discover that God is a shield for us. He's a helper, he's a defender, he picks us up so that we can walk into waters where our faith will not fail. Now, in order for that to happen, what I discover, though, is that, you know, we've got to recognize the presence of God in our life. And Daniel said, the people who know their God shall stand firm and they shall take action. The people that know their God, well, what is it that you know about God? He's more than a great granddaddy sitting on a throne up in heaven. He's more than, Santa that would go and climb on his lap and say, give me, give me, give me, give me. You know, to know our God means that we know Him as a defender. It means that we know Him as an uplifter of our soul. It means that we know Him as a provider in our lives. We know Him as the one who sustains us and helps us walk. The people that know their God. And in the prophecy of Joel, what we come across is that God says, I will pour out my Spirit. It'll come to pass that I'll pour out my Spirit on all flesh. All flesh, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Even the male and the female servants in those days, I will pour out my Spirit. Now, God had previously said in the book of Exodus, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. My presence is there. My Spirit is there. I'll give you rest. Now, what I find in the midst of my fault, in the midst of my failure, in the midst of my struggle, when I'm in the valley, I can find it difficult to obtain that rest. You know what I'm talking about? That peace that lets me sleep. That rest that makes me let go. That release that says, God, I totally and completely trust you. You know why that is? It's because we think we are all fixers. I can fix this. I can turn this nut a little tighter. I can apply pressure here. I can back off here. And God says, come to know me and trust me, and I will give you rest. My Spirit is upon you. My presence goes with you. I give you rest. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. It's to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper will not come. That Helper, in the Gospel of John, the Greek word there is paraclete. Para means all the way around, sideways, side to side, up and down, crossways, every which way. And the cleat, he actually picks us up. He carries us. He supports us. We're completely wrapped. Thou, O Lord, are a shield for me. You realize that the Spirit of God, if you are a Christian, is working in your life to be the shield for you. He's working in your life to protect you. He's working in your life to guide you. He's working in your life to help you be and to become all that God has called you to be and to become. And Jesus declared, recorded in the book of Acts, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You know, our source of power is not another class. It's not another worship service. Our source of power is being connected, being led by the Spirit upon the waters, and our faith standing. And you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the very ends of the earth. And we see the result of that as the church is born in Acts chapter 2, verse 4. The Bible declares that they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. You know why God says we need His Spirit? Because the task at hand. Just the responsibility is me taking care of me living before God is too big. The responsibility of the church doing the task at hand of being His witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the very ends of the earth is too gargantuan. We need His Spirit to empower us. We need His Spirit to move us out upon the waters. We need His Spirit to expand our faith and to walk in obedience. And so we make this decision, okay, God, religion's failed, but I'm not going to walk in religion. I'm going to walk in faith before you. And I know that, God, you want to do great things in me and through me and around me and in our church and all those different kinds of things. Let's go. And then we get in the midst of all this, and what we discover is that once we say, let's go, hell breaks loose, so to speak, at times. And things come against us. To me, this has been one of the most trying weeks that I've been through in a long time. I'm saying, what is going on? Is it because I brought up strongholds last week and tore down at traditions and beliefs and all the things that can hinder us and keep us from being what God has called us to be? And, you know, we think, well, God, if I'm following you and I'm honoring you, everything ought to be cool. But that's not true. Get a hold of this. Adversity is going to come. You're going to face adversity. Even when you follow the Lord, you're going to have adversity. You know, Satan will attack you with little things that shouldn't bother you whatsoever. But it gets to you. It gets under your skin. You know, adversity is going to come, and you're either going to be subdued by it, you're going to be beaten by it, or you can make the positive choice, so to speak, and grow in it. To grow in it. You know, that the word I want to use to grow in it is the word appreciate. I remember in college, you know, there are certain classes that you just don't look forward to taking, or at least for me. You know, getting my Bachelor of Science, I had this choice. Either I could take music appreciation or art appreciation. Anybody with me there? And I heard, you know, that music appreciation was tough because Shorter was known, you know, for its music department. And that the professor had this thing where he would do these drop needle tests. This is back when they had records. You know, for all of you really younger ones, you know, a record is a flat piece of plastic with little grooves in it, and they'd put it on and have a needle that would pick up the sound and play it. And what a drop needle test was, he'd just drop it on the record somewhere, and you had to identify the composer and the piece. No, I'm not doing that. You know, let me go visual. So I went and did art appreciation. And can I tell you that in preparing for those quizzes and exams, there was no appreciation whatsoever? Because we tend to think of appreciation like this. Appreciation's when I like this, when it does something for me. But to appreciate, it means to become aware of the situation. To appreciate means to understand that situation fully. It means to recognize the full implication of that thing. So to appreciate, say, Starry Night by Van Gogh, I can recognize that one. I can, you know, that's a pretty amazing piece of art. So we have to learn, you know, that adversity is going to come, and I'm going to grow in it, and I'm going to learn to appreciate it. I'm going to learn to understand that situation. I'm going to recognize the implications of that situation. And when we're introduced to Gideon, you know, he is experiencing great adversity in his life. The pagan nation of Midian had come in and overthrown Israel. The Midianites were nomadic people who was sweeping to an area. And here's how the scripture describes them in Judges chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. For they would come up with their livestock and their tents, and they would come like locusts in number. Have you ever seen a swarm of locusts? Anybody ever seen a swarm? I've had the experience of seeing a swarm of locusts. I mean, they can be as dark as a cloud. There's so many of them, so many millions of them. It says they'd come in like locusts in number, both they and their camels, and they could not be counted, so that they laid waste the land as they came in. And Israel was brought very low because of Midian, and the people of Israel cried out for help to the Lord. They're brought very low. I mean, morale was down. The outlook was down. They were brought low. And what I get right here, the people cried out to the Lord for help. I want to say that God hears His people, you know, at all times. And the scripture reveals that God has a special place in His heart for His people who cry out in their humility for divine assistance. James, the brother of Jesus, he said this, "Count it all joy, brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds." Now, I don't typically want to count it a joy. I don't like the obstacle. I don't like the rub. I don't like the conflict. I don't like those kinds of things. But the Bible says, count it joy. Count it joy. Why? Well, Peter says, you know, that adversity refines our faith and it makes us more pure. He says that tested, that your genuineness may be tested of faith, and it'd be more precious than gold that perishes, though it's tested by fire, may be found to the result in the praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Christ. And so that adversity is a training ground for God's glory. Think about this. Before the Israelites ever entered the promised land, oh yeah, they were dumb, they were stupid, they left their wallet and their phone and their keys on the bumper in Egypt, on chariots driven by Pharaoh. And what they ended up doing, they ended up wandering around in the wilderness for how many years? 40 years, right? Because they didn't have that Find My iPhone app. You know, they couldn't put it all together. And God would bring about His glory and all that. But before there was a promised land that was filled with milk and honey, there was a dry and hot desert filled with questions and complaints and an awful lot of miles to walk. Before there was a spot right next to Pharaoh for Joseph in the palace, there was a spot right next to thieves and murderers for him in a prison cell because of a false accusation. Before there's a crown on his head and a kingdom to lead for David, there was a staff in his hand and sheep to lead for many days. Before there's a promise kept and the long-awaited baby boy in the arms of Abraham, there are many years of faithfully serving God and trusting God's timing for His promises to be fulfilled. Before there's an open tomb and a resurrection for the Lord Jesus Christ, there is a cross to carry and the sins of a world to bear. And the most painful suffering precedes the most enduring strength. And the hardest battles precede the greatest victories. And sleepless nights, the many tears and hours spent on your knees, precedes answered prayers. And the darkest night precedes the brightest day. And so oftentimes as God is growing us and developing us, He allows us to go through this adversity. And it's in the desert, it's in the valley, it's in the battlefield that God grows us. And you may be in that place today. It may be a battle for your mind. It may be a battle for your heart. It may be a battle in your body. It may be a battle in your relationships. And it's in the desert, just like the Israelites, that we learn to follow God into the promised land. It's in the prison cell, just like Joseph, that we learn to remain faithful no matter what. It's in the fields of sheep, just like David, that we're drawn away from people so that we can become intimate with Christ. And it's in these seasons of life that we learn to trust God and trust God's timing and trust God's power to bring fulfillment, because trials precede triumph. Abraham left his home to follow God. Joseph was thrown into prison before reaching the palace. Moses lived in exile on the backside of a desert before leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. David fled for his life to the cave of Adullam before becoming king. Mary and Joseph fled to Egypt before settling in Nazareth. The Apostle Paul spent 3 years in a desert until Barnabas convinced the apostles to accept his conversion. And that list goes on. Throughout Christian history, adversity has prepared God's people for greater accomplishment. So you need to know what God says about you. You know, so many of us are held in the power of that stronghold that I talked to you about last week. You know, the stronghold that has been fortified so as to protect it. In other words, it's been fortified in your life so that your identity will be drawn there, and that stronghold's got to be broken down. Those strongholds are oftentimes, you know, caught up in our thought patterns because other things have been injected into us, and we believe those words. Sometimes it's our sin. We have not learned to forgive ourselves of the great failure and the great sin. Although heaven has forgiven us, although the blood of Christ has washed us and made us pure, although we're called His child and we're holy, we don't forgive ourselves and we allow that stronghold to hold us. And sometimes it's our beliefs. We get tied in with things that, I mean, they may be good, but they're not necessarily godly. And so, you know, we've got to know what God says about us. We've got to know who we are. You know, when God's dealing with Gideon, Gideon says in chapter 6, verse 15, he says, "Please, Lord, how can I save Israel? How can I do it? Behold, my clan, it's the weakest of Manasseh." Man, I don't even come from good stock. And I'm the least in my father's house. I mean, we're the least clan of Manasseh, and I'm the least of the father's house. I mean, I'm pretty down here close to dirt. I'm kind of like on the barn floor, and I'm covered in all kinds of nastiness. How can I do that? And Gideon was a small man from a little clan, and he lived in fear, and he lived in disobedience. But God declares who and what we are. He declares who and what we are by His grace, by His power, not what we've done in our past or not by even our present circumstances. And He sees beyond our faults. He sees beyond our failures. He sees beyond our limits. And God prophesies over Gideon to give him a new identity. He says, "You are a warrior. You're a warrior, Gideon, because God has said it. You're a warrior, not by your thought processes. You're a warrior, not because others have said it. You are a warrior because I have declared it." And we all need to know what God has to say about us. What is it that God has to say about you? He says, "You are His child. You are His child." He says, "You are His friend." I am a friend of God. Isn't that exciting that I get to be a friend of God? God says, "You are forgiven. You are justified. You are no longer condemned." So get over it. Get rid of that crap in your past and live in the present future of God's grace and holy mercy. He says, "You're my child, you're forgiven, you're justified, you're no longer condemned, and you are more than conqueror." We've been made more than conquerors through Him who loved us. You are His workmanship, created for good works in Christ Jesus. You are a royal priest declaring the good news like a shining star. You, the Bible tells us, you are blood bought. Amen? You're blood bought. You're spirit filled. You're heaven bound. You're a fully equipped warrior with the special armor designed to tear down the strongholds of the enemy. That's who you are. Don't listen to those lies anymore. Be set free. Gideon, your tribe may be small, your family may be small, you may be the youngest in the family, but rise up. You are my child. You're my child. Recognize who you are. And when you recognize who you are, you know, you can act on the authority that's given to you. You know, did you hear about that polar bear cub that was a little bit confused about his identity? He said, "Dad, I am a polar bear cub, right? Is that right? I'm not a lion. I'm a polar bear just like you." And his dad says, "That's right, son. Why are you asking about being a polar bear?" And that cub said, "Well, I'm just making sure because the wind's really cold." Some of y'all get that by snail mail tomorrow. I thought it was cute. You know, sometimes you might question your identity because that wind feels really cold. But remember who you are and act on the authority of who you are. Act on that authority that's been given to you. Obey what God's telling you. Now, God told Gideon, you know, Gideon, I want you to go and fight the Midianites. And he went through this process. We don't have the time to read through all those chapters. But he said, basically, you're going to take 300 men. And it's going to be the men who lap the water that you're going to choose. Well, taking 300 men up against 130,000 Midianite soldiers is not very smart, is it? Unless God tells you to do it. Unless God tells you to do it. As a matter of fact, you know, giving 10% of your income to the Church of Jesus Christ, you know, is kind of crazy until God leads you to do it. Taking a week off of your vacation to serve in vacation Bible school is nuts unless you understand the call of God. Serving on a mission team and paying money to stay in an undesirable hotel with undesirable food after the first meal is foolish unless God has called you to use your gifts for His glory. And remember this, Peter only walked on water after Jesus commanded him to get out of the boat. So, you know, Gideon understands the command of God, and what he does is he throws out a fleece. This is what we know Gideon for the fleece. So, you know, he says, okay, I'm going to put God to the test. I need to know if God's really answering me. And so Gideon, you know, he says to God, if you will save Israel by my hand, if you're really saying this, as you have said, behold, I'm laying a fleece of wool on the threshing floor. If there's dew on the fleece alone and it's dry all around the ground, then I will know that you will save Israel by my hand, as you have said. It's pretty simple. Threshing floor. Those of you that have gone to North Africa with me, you remember the threshing floors that we see in the villages throughout the land of the Berber people. You know, the stone floors where they thresh out the wheat. And so he lays that fleece out there. You know, it's sky above, earth beneath. You know, it's not covered or anything. And it was so. And he rose early, you know, the next morning. He squeezed the fleece, and he wrung enough dew from the fleece to fill a bowl of water. Well, okay, that's pretty obvious, right? Okay, everything else is dry. My fleece is wet. Let's go. Well, listen to Gideon. Then Gideon said to God, let not your anger burn against me. You know, this is where we get into questioning. Let me speak just once more. Please let me test just once more with the fleece. Please let it be dry on the fleece only, and on the ground let it be dew. And God did so that night, and it was dry on the fleece only, and on all the ground there was dew. Well, you know, we lay out our fleeces, so to speak. And we're asking God to direct us. And when God gives us direction, we sometimes doubt and we lay out another fleece. You know, fleeces are not our primary dependable way of understanding the direction of God in our life. Okay, God, you know, if you're really leading me, let me find a quarter laying on the ground. And sure enough, that quarter pops up. So, let me do this. Well, that's not the primary way. God speaks to us through His Word. He speaks to us through His Spirit. He speaks to us through His people. And yes, He does speak in situations as well. You know, God works in many ways, but He guides us primarily by His Word. You know, Jesus told Peter, He said, Peter, so on this rock I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Jesus is going to build His church, and the church is going to advance, and the gates of hell couldn't withstand it. And in 1 John 4:4, the Bible says, "Little children, you are from God and have overcome them, for he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world." Knowing who we are and acting on that authority of who we are, greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. Because you see, his power is greater than the power of the enemy. Paul wrote to the Corinthians in the latter part of chapter 4, 1 Corinthians 4:19-20. He says, "The kingdom of God does not consist in talk, but in power." He prays for the Ephesians and he says, "I pray that you will know what is the immeasurable greatness of his power." We act in that authority. And that authority will bring us to a place of humility. I mean, choosing 300 guys out of all the top fighters of Israel who are caught lapping the water. And it brings us to a place of purity. In Judges 6:25, he said, "Take your father's bull and a second bull 7 years old and pull down the altar of Baal." You know, get rid of the stuff that pulls you away. You know, John wrote and said, "Little children, keep yourselves from idols." That's what was happening in Gideon's life. Get rid of the idols that are around you. You may not worship them, but get rid of them. You know, we all have idols. Did you know that? We worship our money. We worship our possessions. We worship ourselves. We worship all kinds of things. But sometimes the very idols that we need to get rid of are the lies and the strongholds that trip us and tie us down and keep us from being all that God has called us to be. You know, there's an amazing thing about God. God takes our trash and turns it into treasure. Just a few weeks ago when we were in the Dominican Republic, we were at the garbage dump where the missionaries go and they feed the people that are working in that dump. And what I mean by working in the dump, they come into the dump, they jump on the garbage trucks, they ride them in, they get anything out of that garbage they find useful, whether it be food or other things. And then we went to the village where a lot of these garbage dump people have moved to. Maybe their life's improved just a little bit. But I was just thinking about how God takes our trash and turns it into treasure. And probably one of the most memorable moments walking through there, our ladies were out in front praying for the different women as they would come out, and men kind of stand back. There's this woman who's 80-something-ish. And she prayed for them. She prayed for us. And I was thinking about, this most horrible little village. No running water, really. I mean, it's nasty. And out of the trash, God brought a treasure, and it's something that all the women remember very, very vividly. Have you ever heard of a Luwak coffee? Anybody ever heard of Luwak coffee? It is the most expensive coffee in the world. Now, how many of you would like to taste the most expensive coffee in the world? No charge, so you just get a taste. Okay. Morgan Freeman, the actor, and Jack Nicholson, in a movie called The Bucket List, are talking about Luwak coffee. And on the bucket list is to laugh until I cry. And the character that Morgan Freeman has played throughout that movie has talked about Luwak coffee and how great it is. And here's where we pick up as Nicholson tells Freeman where that Luwak coffee comes from.
Read it. Kopi Luwak is the world's most expensive coffee, though for some it falls under the category of too good to be true. In the Sumatran village where the beans are grown lives a breed of wild tree cats. These cats eat the beans, digest them, and then defecate. The villagers then collect and process the stools, It is the combination of the beans and the gastric juices of the tree cat that give Kopi Luwak its unique flavor and aroma. You're kidding me.
Cats beat me to it. You got a pin. Give me a
what?
Pin.
What's on your bucket list? Maybe it's to laugh until you cry. But wouldn't it be great that your bucket list be made up of this? God, I want to live for you. And would you take what others call trash and turn it into treasure in my life? Would you make me like the Luwak coffee? Because I know I've been through the world's process. And would you make me pure to serve you, to love you, to honor you in all the things that I say, in all the things that I do? You know, trash to treasure. Gideon began as a coward. Abraham fled to Egypt. He lied about his wife. He slept with a servant girl. Moses committed manslaughter. David committed adultery and arranged for an innocent man's death. The Apostle Paul described himself as chief among sinners. Others along the way fit into the list of those who needed a transforming touch to save them from the depravity of sin. Trash to treasure is what God does. Jesus was born in a stable, and he was placed in a feeding trough. Jesus grew up in Nazareth, which caused his critics to say, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" When Jesus was crucified, it was at the trash dump of Golgotha. And today we consider the cross, which is that instrument of torture and an enduring symbol of shame, to become the enduring symbol of hope and grace, because God takes garbage and he turns it into greatness. He did it in Gideon's life, and he can do it in your life. Lord, would you lead me out upon the waters? Lord, would you be that shield for me? Lord, help me to sing forever, "Your love come down." My life, let it be that reflection. Ooh, 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 ooh. That's why I don't sing. But "Your love come down." Yeah, "Your love come down and it rescued me." Don't you youth pastors laugh at me. I see that going on over here. They're saying, "Man, I'm glad he's not in our youth band." Can that be our story? Can that be our testimony? I'm going to lead us in prayer. Music team is going to come and lead us in a closeout song. You know, if you want to make a decision, you just got to shoot on down the aisle this morning. Otherwise, you're going to have to hang around a few minutes. And I want you to see this video, because most of you came in before the video, after the video was played. It's a picture of what God did in the Dominican Republic, and it will touch your heart. It's only a minute and a few seconds long. Father, to you be the glory, both now and in your church, throughout all of eternity, forever and ever and ever. God, be honored in us. Lord, would you be a shield for us? Would you lead us where our faith is without borders, out upon the water. And Lord, would you help me to sing, ooh, 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 your love come down. In Jesus' name, amen.
Every time I speak, I wanna run to the world.